Will you please stand and join me in blessing? Blessed Assurance, United Methodist Hymn 369, or it's projected on the screen.
Yeah. Before we go into this time of prayer together, I want us to lift up, so feel free to speak, names of saints that have passed before us. So if you lost a loved one or friend, go ahead and offer their name up, and then we'll join with each other in prayer.
Vaughn Hoffmeyer.
Joyce Miller. Mary Anderson.
Ruth Donovan.
Tim Moore.
Will Campmeyer.
Ruthann Wilcher.
Please remain standing for the unison prayer. Almighty God,
your people of all ages live and praise you without ceasing. And on our community with you, we have a community with generations past and generations yet unborn. Yet for your throne, we are one with the great multitude.
Human beings made in God's likeness. So this passage is telling us that
We can tame animals, right? We have like wild dogs and all kinds of animals that can be tamed to be tamed, right? To be nice and everything. But our tongue can sometimes get us in trouble. Has anybody, you don't have to share, but has anybody got their tongue in trouble? Anybody blame it on the tongue? Always blame it on the tongue, right? That's right. So sometimes we say things that we probably shouldn't say. And we do things that we probably shouldn't do. And then in the other lesson today, it says, don't let any foul words come out of your mouth. And I'm sure you guys haven't done that. It says, only say, don't tell me if you have, only say what is helpful. Only say what is helpful when it is needed for building up the community so that it benefits those who hear what you say. Don't make the Holy Spirit of God unhappy. You were sealed by him for the day of redemption. Put aside all bitterness, losing your temper, anger, shouting, and slander, all along with every other evil. So what is this message telling us? What is it telling us? What should we not do? We shouldn't be bad. That's true. Okay, what else? Do I say mean things? What else? Yes. Don't say the bad words. Very good. Very good. And does this? Yes, Liam. Don't back talk. Oh, I'm liking this lesson. So don't do all of those things. And not just us, but our parents and our grandparents and pastors and like everybody, right? Sometimes, so what this message is saying is to remember, there's other parts of this message that aren't right here, but to remember that God made all of us, right? Every single one of us, even the people that, don't say names, but even the people that we really have a hard time liking, right? There are people that make it really hard to like them. Don't say names, I saw that. They make it super duper hard to like them, right? But who made them? Who made those people? God made those people, and God made us. So we are the same as those people, right? And so this week, I encourage you, and I'm going to try to, because that's what I've been doing every Sunday for the last 8 Sundays. I've got up in the morning, and I've said, okay, God, please help me go to worship today. Please help me to love you and to worship you and to focus on the good and not to worry about anything bad. And to try to only speak good. Now, do you think I've done a really good job of that? Not so much. I've tried, but I failed. So this week, I invite each of you to remember that everybody you meet, God made. And God made them for a purpose, just like God made you. And try really, really hard to be nice to them, even when they're not nice to you. Can you do that? All right. That doesn't mean that if they do something super bad, you shouldn't go tell, and I'm not telling you any of that. But try really hard. When someone is having a really bad day, they usually project that on other people, right? But if you can meet their bad day with a smile, and hey, you know what? Are you doing okay today? Can I talk to you? Can I play with you? You might just be surprised. You might change how they act. And it may not happen, because I see you're looking at me like, that doesn't always work, right? It doesn't always work, but keep doing that. And more than anything, you know what else you can do? You can pray. Pray for God to help you and to help them to be a better person and to remember that everybody we meet them with love and grace, just as God did for us. Can you do that? All right, let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this beautiful day as we remember the saints before us and those that have helped lead the way in our discipleship towards you. God, we know that sometimes it's not easy being a Christian. It's not easy being nice to people that aren't always nice to us. But help us to meet them with love and grace, just as you meet us with love and grace each and every day. Be with these children, be with this congregation as we leave this place today to disciple others and to draw them close to you. And all God's people said, amen. All right, you guys can go to children's church. Have a good day.
The first New Testament lesson for today comes from James 1, verses 19 to 20, and 3, verses 7 to 10. You can find this in your pew Bible on page 980. Note this, my dear brothers and sisters, Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to grow angry. This is because an angry person doesn't produce God's righteousness. People can tame, and already have tamed, every kind of animal, bird, reptile, and fish. No one can tame the tongue, though. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it, we both bless the Lord and Father, and curse human beings made in God's likeness. Blessing and cursing come from the same mouth. My brothers and sisters, it just shouldn't be this way. Our second New Testament lesson comes from Ephesians 4, verses 29 to 32. It can be found in a few Bibles, page 951. Don't let any foul words come out of your mouth. Only say what is helpful when it is needed for building up the community so that it benefits those who hear what you say. Don't make the Holy Spirit of God unhappy. You were sealed by Him for the day of redemption. Put aside all bitterness, losing your temper, anger, shouting, and slander, along with every other evil. Be kind, compassionate, and forgiving to each other in the same way God forgave you in Christ. The Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in musical response. It is well with my soul.
And welcome to everyone.
So I want to acknowledge up front, we're in the middle of a sermon series talking about controversial topics that we are experiencing in the political realm. And I want to acknowledge up front that there's a little bit of hesitancy to talk about these things with each other at home, definitely at church,
but not if you're at the Wednesday men's group coffee. And so I think that is because many of these issues divide us. They say, take a stand here, but you can't take a stand here, too. We don't want to hear what God might have to say about a particular issue or a certain political issue. We don't want to hear that from another person, let alone a pastor. And so we don't want to hear who people should tell us what we should think, what we should say, who we should vote for. And so last week, we began this series talking about compassionate accountability and what that looks like and when we experience conflict or controversy. We learned that Jesus was compassionate, showering people with his unending love, grace, and mercy. But we also learned that Jesus held people accountable for their actions. And so the definition that we worked with last week was compassionate accountability is struggling with each other through conflict. It is a process of mutuality and creation. It is about seeing the solution as a win-win for everyone, viewing the struggle and adopting the attitude of shared responsibility for resolving the gap between what we want and what we are experiencing. And so this week we're going to talk about political parties and how our faith leads us to practice politics. And then the next 2 weeks for the trajectory for the future, last week I invited everyone to write a topic on the board in which they would like us to discover and unpack together. And so I've been compiling those, so I'd invite you to also, this week as you leave, to write more topics on the board, and we'll begin to look at those. What does our faith say about those scriptures? How can we struggle with those issues together as Christians? And so I want to begin to tell you today what I am not going to do. I'm not going to tell you one party has all the answers. Both parties get things right. Both parties get things wrong. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for. I'm also not going to tell you how you might think about a certain topic or issue. Because these issues are complex. They're controversial. And so there's no simple way to understand or unpack them. It takes time to unpack them. It takes conversation to unpack them. But my hope is that as we explore scripture, we might see how our faith leads us to practice politics. So we might be more prone to listen to one another, more open to hearing the voices of one another. And so I want us to practice politics in such a way we keep faith. That is, as we as Christians act, we act as Christians when we practice politics. And so that takes us to the passage of scripture from James that we read today. And in this passage of scripture, we can assume a lot of biblical scholars think that James wrote the book. And so James, we can say, was the brother of Jesus. Is estimated to be written between 600 AD and 70 AD. It was written between in divisive times, much like we are experiencing today. There's division between the Sadducees, Pharisees, and Zealots. The early church apostles, they were immersed in conflict between the Jews and Gentiles, but also in the political realm. In Rome, if it was written in this time, the Great Fire of Rome was in 64 AD. And that was why Emperor Nero was the emperor of Rome. And there's division between Christians and the Romans because Nero said the Christians lit the fire. And so that was a political divide between the Romans and the Christians. And so that is the context of scripture that James has written. And so I want to read James 19, chapter 1, 19 to you. Again, because it is a response to these divisive times, it says, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to grow angry. In one commentary I read, it said, it is putting aside all those qualities of arrogance and desire and rage that go against God's righteousness, and putting on the qualities of meekness and hearing to enable us to be shaped, formed, and molded by the word of truth. And as Methodists, going back to our heritage as Methodists, Methodists actively took a stance in the role of the world and the role of politics and how our faith can play a part in that. And specifically, John Wesley, he combined personal piety, which is ourselves and how we engage with God's grace, with social piety and how we as a social community engage and experience God's grace, love, mercy, and justice together. And he said, so I just want to read this from the United Methodist Church. We believe God's love for the world is an active and engaged love, a love seeking justice and liberty. We cannot just be observers. We care enough about people's lives to risk interpreting God's love, to take a stand, to call each of us into a response. No matter how controversial or complex an issue is, the church helps us think and act out our faith perspective, not just responding to all the other mind makers up, so that'd be the politicians or people that are leading that exist in our society. The temptation to speak evil of those whom we disagree with is not new. Christians throughout time have been wrestling with this. When John Wesley was starting the Methodist movement, we were wrestling this as a denomination, and we continue to wrestle with this today. John Wesley, in his journal, he said we should do three things when we vote. So for us, that's Tuesday, November 6th. He had three points to keep in mind when we go make a vote. He wrote, "I met those of our society who had votes in the ensuing election." And so back then, not everybody could vote. Only certain people could vote. And John Wesley advised them to vote without fee or reward for the person they judged most worthy. Notice it doesn't say political party, doesn't mention one, just vote for those who they found most worthy. To speak no evil of the person they voted against. So that sounds a lot different than I'm looking forward to Wednesday so I don't have to hear the evil and all those political ads. To take care of their spirits, we're not sharpened against those that voted on the other side. And so when you engage in conversations with people who might have voted differently, don't cast ill will at them. Be able to enter into a dialogue with them. And so in a sense, he's speaking to this to having this civil discussion with one another when we talk about politics and how our faith interacts with politics. Because we see and have witnessed too many times where we have lost all civility with one another when we engage in these conversations that are hard to have. We hold our own views without humility instead of holding them with humility when we engage in someone that has a different view than us. We've forgotten to have thoughtful, respectful discussions and dialogue, and we share our thoughts kind of without thinking about the repercussions they might have. Social media is a good way to where this acts out. We type something up and we just hit click. And we don't think about who will be reading it, how people will interpret it. It's an easy way to not respect the views of other when we hit click and not thinking of who we are interacting with. I don't think we're not supposed to share our views with one another. I don't think that's the answer, because we do that. And we do that freely now. The problem comes when we assume that we have all the answers and when we don't. I know there's many times where I've had to enter into conversation with people and I'm like, okay, don't remove all the assumptions that I have and carry with that issue so I can get and have a healthy dialogue, and so that not only the conversation can be fruitful, but that I can grow and learn from another person, and that person might be able to grow and learn from my conversation with them too. And so the problem there is the assumptions that our opinions are right and the other person's opinions might be wrong. And like I said before, these controversies or topics or conflicts, there's no like simple, straightforward answer, or they would have all been figured out by now. We wouldn't be wrestling with this. They wouldn't cause you to a sweat when you hear it being talked about. They wouldn't cause you to kind of look the other way or walk out of the room when someone starts talking about an issue. They're complex. And so I want that to sit with you. These issues are complex. And so when we speak with someone that might have a different perspective, I want to encourage you to not mischaracterize them, to not lump them together with, oh, those people think that, or not attribute motives to them about what they might be saying, but just kind of to understand that this is how they understand the issue, this is their perspective, and maybe to gain a greater understanding about them as a person, not about what they believe or what they are speaking, but as them as a person. And so I think it is this is how we begin to share our views with one another without poking fun of lightheartedly about these controversial topics. It's because we have an eye for dialogue and conversation, an eye towards the other person and what is inside of them and not their belief or views. But this today is still something we struggle with as a society, as a culture, as the early church did. And we see the Apostle Paul's letters, his epistles, a majority of their dialogue is about conflict. To the church in Corinth, there's conflict. The church in Ephesus, conflict. All these churches were experiencing conflict, and that is a bulk of what Paul is addressing. And that's no different than what we read in the book of Ephesians today. And so Ephesians 4:29 might be worth memorizing or reciting to yourself, but when you enter into these conversations that might become heated or you kind of feel yourself getting worked up about these issues, and it reads, "Don't let any foul words come out of your mouth. Only say what is helpful when it is needed for building up community, so it benefits all that hear it." What do you think the political arena today might look like if those words were taken to heart? What do you think our community here in Silver Lake would look like if those words were taken to heart? Scholar N.T. Wright said, "Your tongue gives you the opportunity to bring God's grace to people by what you say and how you say it. It's a shame to pass up that chance. You should behave as those whom God's Holy Spirit has placed God's mark. The word Paul uses, he says, could be referred to as a seal or an official stamp or document. The mark indicates who it belongs to and what it is for. People who are enslaved to anger and malice may think they are free to be themselves, but they are in bondage. If we are marked out by the Spirit's personal presence living within us, think how sad it makes that Spirit if we behave in ways in which we don't reflect God's love and grace and life for all people." So before you talk with someone or before you hit forward on an email or post something on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, you might ask yourself, does this offer God's grace? Before you respond to someone who might have put something on Facebook or had a conversation, you might say, does this offer God's grace? Does this build that person up? Does it build our community up? Or you could just ask, can I picture Jesus sending this? When people criticize your beliefs on social media, I ask you to do these things. One of the best things you can do is invite them into a conversation with you. Don't invite them into a conversation about what they believe or why they believe it, but invite them into a conversation to understand who they are. Who they are as people, what things in their lives have made them the people that they are today. And in doing this, I think we'll see how connected we are to each other through our individual experiences and not how divided we are. And so you might been wondering, what is that picture been placed up there the whole time? And that picture is from the Burning Man Festival. They construct this city in the Nevada desert each year. It's called a Black Rock City, and it's just temporarily erected for this festival. And this is a a sculpture, and I think this is what it looks like when, for those adults and older people in the room, when we get in arguments. We sit, our backs are against each other. We don't really want to know or want to have a conversation with the other person that is hard. But inside of us is this inner child that is always constantly reaching out to the other person. We want that relationship, that we want that dialogue. And so I think that is what James and what Paul is trying to tell us in Ephesians, that even when we disagree with each other on issues, there's this inner child within each one of us that is always reaching out to the other person. So I ask you, how can you be more like that child inside the sculpture than the adult that is looking away? And so I want to conclude by saying, I'm unable to say where Jesus might stand with 100% on all these issues that are present in the current election, immigration, homosexuality, you name it. I'm unable to say where Jesus would stand 100% with an issue or against an issue. But I can say with 100% that Jesus would interpret each issue through the lens of love. So what would Jesus say as we get ready to vote to each one of us on Tuesday? I would think Jesus would say, I gave each one of you a voice. Use it. Go to, if you're polling places here, come to the church on Tuesday and vote. If you're somewhere else, go and vote. And as we enter into those conversations that are controversial and complex with one another, I think he would say, remember not only my words, but remember the words of my brother James, who helped all those early Christians deal with those issues that divided them and created controversy and conflict amongst them. And so I want you to join me in reading James 1:19, which will be up on the screen. Please join me. Everyone should be quick to listen, so to speak, and slow to grow angry. And I want you to remember this. God gave us two ears and one mouth as a direct proportion, so how we should use them. Amen. And so I want to pause before we go into continue the Apostles' Creed. I want to ask Bob and Arlene to come up here. Or we can stand down here so you don't have to come up. But I want to recognize Bob and Arlene are the newest members of our church family. And so I want all of you to know that and recognize that. And I want to ask you a couple questions. Is that okay? So Bob and Arlene, will you join us and follow the model of Jesus Christ to bring love and justice to all of God's creation, to love both the powerless and the powerful, and to seek to bring wholeness to all of humanity?
I will.
Will you join us with the United Methodist Church to explore questions of Christian faith through the Wesleyan perspective, combining personal holiness and social holiness?
I will.
Will you join us with the support of this community of faith through our prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness, so that together we may grow stronger in expressing God's love for everyone? And so this is just a small gift from the congregation to you. I only have one, so you might have to decide who gets it one morning and the next morning, okay?
That's fine.
All right, and then I want to ask you, as a community of faith, do you promise to care for and support Bob and Arlene as they journey to become disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world and to strengthen them on that journey? Amen.
Thank you very much. Please join me in the Apostles' Creed. This used to be an early membership vow of the church that confesses our faith and what we believe. So please join me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was
was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
At this time, the ushers will come forward with the attendance notebooks, and if you would, please sign in and pass them down to the end of the aisle and look at who's sitting beside you if you don't know them, and greet them by name after worship. Let's continue to worship with "I Need Thee at Every Hour," hymn number 397.
Thank you. we may hear you clearly. We offer to you this day all the facets of our lives, whether it be at home, at work, or at school, to be patient, to be merciful, to be generous, to be holy. Give us the wisdom and insight to understand your will for us, and the fervor to carry out our good intentions. We offer our gifts of time, talent, and possessions to you as a true act of faith, to reflect our love for you and our neighbor. Help us to reach out to others as you, our God, have reached out to us. Amen.
You may be seated.
Continue to worship by singing hymn number 393, Spirit of the Living God. Victory is ours through your Son, Jesus Christ. We often fail to use our words and actions to strengthen each other, to strengthen the community, or build each other up. We are quick to speak and don't always listen. In this moment of silence, we lift up those times from this past week where we did not refrain from using our words to speak against each other. We pause and remember to lift up our Jewish brothers and sisters at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh. In the wake of last week's terror inflicted on them, may our prayers become our actions. We lift those up in our community who are hurting and struggling, those who are dealing with health issues, making difficult decisions, going through a life transition, grieving the loss of loved ones, and all the other things that we go through on a daily basis. May this community be one which shows your love, grace, and mercy through caring and supporting one another, through caring and supporting not only just the Silver Lake community, but the community beyond and the world. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, and his example of how we might carry out your love. We pray all these things in his name and continue to pray as he taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's continue to worship by celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion. And I want you to remember on the night before Jesus was arrested, he sat down with his group of disciples. And before the meal, he took bread. And broke it and said, "This is my body. Every time you eat of it, remember me." And then after the meal was over, he took the cup. And he said, "This is my blood. This is the new covenant in which I have with you. And so every time we partake of this, it is remembering that Christ is within us. Christ is with all of us in this community." And so as we celebrate that meal, I want us to remember not only that, but remember that Christ, his new covenant, his new blood is poured out on all. And that all are welcome to celebrate this meal with us. Whether you're a member here or not, a visitor, or come here regularly, all are welcome at this table. And so I would invite those that are helping with communion to come forward so we can begin to serve, and also the ushers to come forward. So they can give direction.
Thank you.
Let's please rise as we stand our closing hymn, Be Thou My Vision. And the words will be up on the screen, but they'll also be found in your hymnal on page 451. Slow to speak and slow to be angry. Amen.